Hello, and thank you for joining this session talking about the brain and technology. I'm going to share my screen with you and I will show you a presentation. Dear all, brain is a fascinating network of time, one of the most fascinating. And today, neuroscience explains most of the secrets of the brain. It can help us fulfill our dreams and solve problems. But how do we update and make this knowledge available in a modern format? Because we need neuroscience in a new wrapping, and that is what this talk is about. As a medical doctor, ear, nose and throat specialist, and professor of health innovation in the business school, and with my main job as the CEO of health innovation, I'm very curious by nature, and I always believe from I was a little child that everything is possible. You can make your dreams come true if you really strive and work for it. It should be said, though, that I was not old before I realized that everything is not easy and everything is not possible. But I still believe we should never stop fighting and never stop thinking about rebooting our world. As a doctor, professor, and cognitive trainer, I have published a book called Brain Mysteries that explores the relationship between our brain network, the decisions we all make, and the way we lead ourselves and the way we are. And in short, we know today that permanent change is possible, but it takes 8 weeks to change a small habit, and also that we have to be motivated, so we need motivational cues on the way, which means it's not enough to write the book, but how can we have everyone get this knowledge, make this knowledge available through technology? And that's what I hope you have some ideas for me about. But first, to the brain. The brain is fantastic. A tangible mass of billions of neurons, almost like a computer. But there are some differences. It is like when neurons or cells fire together, they wire together and make strong bonds. But we have to keep practicing in order for these bonds to get strong enough. And also, we live with our emotions, and we have to keep our emotions under control if we should be able to rewire our brain. And it's not really like that with the computer, is it? So let's move to the emotions. For instance, is social pain a real pain? The researcher Naomi Eisenberger set up a cyberball game to check this. She and her group invited volunteers to play a computer game of catch with two others. And the whole structure was set up so that the volunteer thought he or she played with two other people, but it was just two avatars on the internet. In the beginning of this game, the characters played nicely and everyone got the ball. But after a while, the volunteer was excluded and never got the ball. And this game was going on while the brain was scanned. And when we looked into the brain, what did we find? We actually found that even when we think we are rational, we are not. Because in the brain thought that social pain was exactly like when you hurt yourself physically. It feels very bad. And also, the more you felt socially excluded during that game, the worse you felt and the more pain you felt. which means that we really are humans with a lot of emotions, even if we sit behind the computer. And I think that's important to recognize. And then I would also like to ask you guys what you think. Because when artificial intelligence and technology is used to the extent that it's used today and to the extent that it will be used tomorrow, which will be even a lot more when you contribute, what happens to our emotions? Is it possible to keep our emotions under control, or is it possible actually to include how we should change emotions or process emotions in this process? What happens to us? What happens to our mood? How do we do that? And that is really up to you guys, because I think we will always have these emotions, and I will explain why. Because we are born with this evolutionary brain that is billions of years old, which means that we still strive to survive. So we used to say that our brain consists of three parts. It's the really old, the sensing brain, that is our survival brain. It's for reproduction. It's for fight, fright, and flight. So it takes care of us, so we survive. But we also have the feeling brain, which also is an old part of the brain. It makes us have strong feelings when we react to things. And then if we think of the brain as a set amount of energy, and we want a lot of that energy to be our thinking brain, because that's what we think we are most of the time, the smart people. If we are filled with emotions, it will only be a small, tiny portion again for rationality and thinking. That means that we have to have our emotions in control if we should think wisely. So think it over. If you are really upset about something, maybe that's not the day you're the smartest guy. And the opposite. When you feel really calm and you have good friends around you, maybe that's when your good ideas arrive. I don't know. And then I also would like to introduce you to the mirror neurons that was discovered around 1995 that shows that we use our bodies to communicate our intentions and feelings, even if we don't think we do. So when I see you guys smile, or when I smile to you, you will recognize that smile, and you will have a tendency to think that you want to smile yourself. When you listen to my voice, you will hear from my voice whether it's really stressed or if I'm calmer. You will look at my face, we look at each other's faces, and we read expressions on the face, which means that this also has to be incorporated when we think of technological solutions, because that's our non-verbal communication. And non-verbal communication consists of probably about 85% of our communication. I love our mirror neurons. I just have to say that, and I think they're great. And you use them all the time. So now I'd like to put you on a little test. If you look at this woman, is she surprised? Do you think she's sure about something, happy or joking? I guess a few of you found that she was sure about something. Let's do this over. How about this young guy? Is he friendly, sad, worried, or surprised? Are you sure? Yes. He's friendly. So now let's move over to our emotions. Amygdala is a part of our emotional system, and I call it our 911 brain response. I guess if you heard this sound, and if it had been really loud, your heart rate would increase and you would feel kind of a stress in your body. And that's because when the amygdala is stimulated, we immediately feel fear. And the reason is that we need to protect our body. So it's the old parts of our brain that's working. So I'll set you up for a little challenge. You have to watch closely here.
Watch this series of images very closely. Ready? Go. Do you recall seeing any shoes or keys? Probably not. At this speed, 80% of the people we showed this to don't see either the shoes or the keys. We'll slow it down. Did you see them this time? You probably did. Now, we're going to play a different series of images and test you on them after. Ready? Go. Did you happen to notice any snakes?
I assumed you did. And that's not because everything was speeded up in the second sequence. It's because our brain is set up to recognize danger. So that's our amygdala that is constantly scanning like a smoke detector. And think about it. This is what happens every day. So when something scares you, it takes a lot of energy. And a threat is something you never forget. Which again means that in order to protect us, we humans are set up so that resistance to change is our brain's first choice because we're supposed to survive. And this is kind of a problem when we want to reboot the world, when we want to do things differently, because in a way we have to win over our old brain. We have to keep the old brain quiet in order to have the energy to be rational and use our thinking brain. So think about it. You probably like to meet the same friends, kind of do the same things. And if people want you to do something completely different, you have to think it over. You have to redo things. You have to set up your mind to do something else. Also when people try to convince you to join you. So this is kind of a not good default setting of our brain, and we need technology sort of to help us, motivate us to do things in a different way. So I'd like you to help me a little, because we're talking about change very soon. I love this picture. It tells us that change is possible throughout life, and you can see the network of the brain, and you see how the cells connect with each other. And we want strong connections of the new things that we want to achieve. But in order to be able to change and to change permanently, we need practice. And now, please help me. If you take up your phone and check, do you have any new messages on your phone? Good, thank you. That was quick and easy, wasn't it? So let's do it again. Now recheck, but use your opposite hand to do exactly the same things and look for the same thing. Yes, it's not that hard, is it? But a little different, takes a little more time, a little more thinking. That's because you normally do this thing with only one of your hands, and you have to train the other if you want to automatically grab the phone by your other hand. So that means you have to do some work to it in order to automate it in your brain. Because if you want to automate it, you make it a habit and your thinking brain doesn't need to use energy on it anymore, but your subconsciousness takes care of it and you don't need to worry about it. So that's how change happens. So a big learning for me, it takes 8 weeks to change a small habit. So in 8 weeks, you will do this perfectly well with the other hand. And also, we do automate a lot of things. You just don't think it over. When you change your passwords, if you use passwords, we often spend some time to redo it. And if you think when you were a little child, probably someone told you to brush your teeth. And there is a reason you may not go to bed without thinking, should I brush my teeth? It's because someone told you over and over, did you brush your teeth? Did you brush your teeth? Did you brush your teeth? And what I'm asking you guys for is to think, is there a way we can do this with technology? So by now, we know what it takes to make a change. And we also know that everyone doesn't sit down to read 297 pages to understand what you should do and then go out and practice it for weeks and weeks and weeks, because it's really hard to keep motivated. Have any of you tried really hard to make a change and discovered, like, after 3 or 5 days, that it's really hard to stick to the new rules to yourself? Most of us have that experience, because people can achieve things, but it's really hard to keep the good habits we establish. And that's due to what I talked about, that the default of the brain is resistant to change, which means someone needs to motivate us, to call me up, to send me a text message, to make me do some fun in order to stick to the new routine that I want to achieve. So we know what it takes, awareness and motivation, some key knowledge, and it's good to have some knowledge about the brain and how we react. And 8 weeks of motivating clues for a small change. And the big changes, like turning a big boat around, consist of a lot of habit changes, and that takes time. But once we start on this way and succeed in the small steps, it's easier to proceed. So that's what we know. So my question then is, are you a workaholic, gameaholic? Do you need some help for anger management, or wish you did it different? Do you want to use your brain better? Do you want to get rid of bad habits? Or maybe to help people act differently in this COVID-19 situation, where there really is a need for every one of us to have a different habit structure? Well, then you have the answer. The key message is that permanent change is possible, and that it takes 3 things: an awakening cue, some key knowledge, and 8 weeks of routines with motivating clues. And so far, I have the ability to come. But then the question is, how can we use technology to train our brain? The world needs to be aware of how the brain can help us. It's not difficult, but we have to know how we should conquer our resistance and how we should get motivated or help motivate other people. And I know that technology can do a lot of these things, but I don't know myself how, so I'm asking you guys for ideas. And you'll actually find this question posted at the Reboot the World. And I'd be really happy if you come up with something, because this can be of help for all kinds of problems we have, for the small problems and for larger problems, and actually for working in the right direction. So what I've talked to you about is to start with the mysteries of our brain, and I've just given you a small portion of all the fantastic things that we know and all the training we can do and things we can set up. But there is a need for a digital update. We are really out of date with our old books. It's not very tempting, and it's not very easy to spread the knowledge and invite for having fun. But we've also been told that permanent brain rewiring is possible, that we can look at the brain in many ways as a computer, as we handle a computer, how we should wire things so they remain permanent for us. And then I've asked you, how would you do it? So I hope you have some ideas on this during the conference and maybe can work on it. Or I would be happy if you contacted me on my Gmail address. And this is actually what I would like to tell you about. So thank you. If you have any comments or any questions, I'll be happy to look at them. Okay. Well, I think I did not see anything from our live comments, but I hope you would be happy to work with that idea later on the campus. And I wish you luck for the conference. And I would like to thank you all for listening to me and for this organizing event, which I strongly believe in. Thank you.